This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. J.m.w. Turner. A Biography. By Howard Brinkley. Bookcap Study Guides. www.bookcaps.com. Copyright 2014. All rights reserved. Table of Contents. About Life Caps. Introduction. Chapter 1, Early Life. Chapter 2, Education. Chapter 3, Early Career. Chapter 4, Later Life and Career. Chapter 5, Joseph Mallord, William Turner and John Ruskin. Chapter 6, Last Works. Chapter 7, Death and Legacy. Bibliography. About Life Caps. Life Caps is an imprint of Bookcap's study guides. With each book, a lesser-known or sometimes forgotten life is recapped. We publish a wide array of topics, from baseball and music to literature and philosophy, so check our growing catalog regularly, www.bookcaps.com, to see our newest books. Introduction. In 2005, the British Broadcasting Corporation sponsored a program to find the greatest painting in Britain. Any painting hanging in a British art gallery was eligible to become the greatest painting in Britain, whether it was created by an Englishman or not. This was the first survey of its kind ever conducted, and was not a frivolous exercise for the organizers, who explained the competition as a way to tell us a great deal about how 21st-century, multicultural Britain sees itself. After every work of art in the country was evaluated, a short list of finalists by British, Italian, Dutch, Belgian, and French artists was announced. There were heavy hitters like Still Life, Vase with 15 Sunflowers by Vincent Van Gogh, that had set a record for the most money ever paid for a work of art when it sold for $40 million in 1987, since eclipsed about 36 times. Also on the list was one of the most original works in the Western world's art canon, the Arnolfini Portrait by Netherlands painter Jan van Eyck in 1434, perpetrated with oils on three panels of oak boards. The home team was represented by London painter and printmaker William Hogarth's A Rake's Progress, a comic strip series of canvases which pioneered sequential art in the 1700s, David Hockney, the only living artist on the list, who was recognized for a composition of Mr. and Mrs. Clark that drew heavily on both the Arnolfini Portrait and A Rake's Progress to represent fashion designer Ossie Clark, and The Hay Wain, a large oil on canvas by John Constable celebrating the English rural life that had long been revered as one of England's greatest paintings. In the end, the vote was not all that close. The winner was The Fighting Téméraire, Tugged to Her Last Berth to Be Broken Up, 1838, painted by a contemporary and bitter rival of Constable, Joseph Mallord William Turner. If the greatest painting in Britain was a referendum on how Brits saw themselves in the 21st century, it was as a wistful people looking back on their days as the greatest naval power on earth. The poll that attracted more than 110,000 votes could also be seen as a final coronation of the early 19th century painter himself. J.m.w. Turner was admired for his talent and technique, especially with watercolors and eventually oils as well, but seldom revered among his peers, who considered him crass of personality and lacking in proper breeding. Those were the critics who liked his work. The scolds who did not cater to his romantic canvases hated them all the more for the unpleasantness of the man who created them. Not that Turner was one to clip out negative reviews and post them on his studio wall. He was secretive and prolific in his paintings, and did more than any other artist to elevate landscape painting to the lofty status of historical painting that was universally held to be the highest form of Western painting. Turner knew his rightful place among the old masters. 150 years after his death, the people of England agreed with him. Chapter 1, Early Life. The last time the sheep and cattle market town of South Moulton in the Shire of Devon blazed prominently on English radar was in 1655. John Penruddock, who was a member of the Sealed Knot, a secret society of royalists agitating for the restoration of the monarchy, selected South Moulton as the place for him to lead the association's largest revolt. The Penruddock Uprising was easily put down in a few hours by Oliver Cromwell's troops, and for his troubles, the 36-year-old colonel's head was severed from the rest of his body. This is where Joseph Mallord William Turner's people lived. His grandfather began shearing human heads as well as sheep's fleece, but there were not enough heads in South Moulton for two barbers to prosper, so his son William set out from southwestern England to practice his trade in the big city of London in 1770. William Turner settled in the heart of London at 26 Maiden Lane in the working-class district of Covent Garden, opening his barbering business and wig-making shop just a few blocks from the River Thames. William, spare and muscular, had an engaging manner and great reserves of energy. He was gregarious and flashed an ever-present smile and quickly established an amiable presence for his business on Maiden Lane. Here the young haircutter met Mary Marshall, said to be a member of Shelford Manor in Nottinghamshire with roots going back to King Henry II in the 12th century. By the 18th century, however, what privileges may have once accrued to her family had eroded. Mary had a brother who was a fishmonger on the docks of the North Sea at Margate, and another working as a butcher in Brentford west of London. On August 29, 1773, William Turner, aged 28, and Mary Marshall, who was a rare maiden to wed for the first time at age 34, were married at St. Paul's Cathedral, the masterwork of architect Sir Christopher Wren. William and Mary's first child arrived on April 23, 1775, 4 days after the first shots were fired in the American colonies at Lexington and Concord. He was given the name of his mother's oldest brother, Joseph. A little sister was born in 1778 and named after her mother, but Mary Ann would die just days before her fifth birthday. Joseph Mallord William Turner would thereafter grow up as an only child. It became apparent early on that young Joseph would not be following his relatives behind a counter in an English shop. Even before he entered school, he was demonstrating a talent for art by sketching out a coat of arms for a local jeweler from a set of casters, and at the age of 9 he completed a detailed drawing of the church in his uncle's seaside town of Margate that was kept and treasured by a resident named John White. William told anyone who listened about his boy, the artist. Chapter 2: Education. At the age of 10, following an illness, Joseph went away from the city to school in Brentford, where he lived with his uncle the butcher. He was kept busy coloring engravings from Henry Boswell's recently released Antiquities of England and Wales for a local distiller who paid him a fourpence, a silver coin worth 4 pennies per engraving. Copies of the engravings were sent to his father, who put them for sale in his shop, where many of his customers were literary figures, actors, architects, and painters who required their powdered wigs teased. The copied engravings and young Turner's own drawings sold well, enough so that William reluctantly gave up his dream of his son continuing in the family tradition of barbering and wig-making. In 1786, young Turner was sent to a school on Soho Square to receive his first art instruction with a floral drawing master named Police. He already seemed to be well beyond that point, being busily employed copying watercolors, coloring prints, and making his own sketches. John Raphael Smith, a respected engraver and print seller, sent regular work to both Turner and a fellow fledgling artist 2 months his senior, Thomas Girton. Turner and Girton became friends who would in short time become flag bearers for the establishment of watercolor as a fine art form. Sickly again at the age of 13 in 1788, Turner was sent back to the seacoast at Margate, where he enrolled in school for about 6 months, the longest sustained formal education he would ever receive. The following year, back in London, he attended a school headmastered by Thomas Malton. Unable to keep up in math and geometry, Joseph was sent home as being stupid and unteachable. Turner held no grudges but recognized his deficiencies with regards to practical learning. He would in later writings revel in his time as an architectural draftsman under Malton and refer to him as my real master. Away from the classroom, Turner painted scenery for London theaters, where he picked up a lasting affection for opera and stage music. All the while, Turner was doing work for local architects, washing in skies and backgrounds to their drawings. Thomas Hardwick was so impressed with the young man's improvements to his architectural work that he advised Joseph to pursue a course as a landscape painter, and urged William to send his son to the Royal Academy schools. The Royal Academy of Arts had been founded by King George III in 1768, and rapidly became the country's leading society of artists. Classes were held in the sprawling Somerset House that had been designed in a neoclassical style by Sir William Chambers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.